This is my official petition to relabel plastic fracked plastic. Right now, hundreds of millions of people are taking part in Plastic Free July, a commitment to say no to single-use plastic items for a whole month. And recently, more nations than ever have proposed legislation to stem the flow of plastic production and ban certain single-use plastics. But at the same time, petrochemical companies that make plastic are investing billions of dollars in new factories. And the World Economic Forum predicts plastic production will double in the next 20 years. So where is the disconnect? Why is the plastics industry doubling down when more people than ever are trying to prevent its growth?
The fracking boom in the last decade and a half in the United States has made the US into an important player when it comes to energy. And it's also turning the US into an important player when it comes to plastic.
That's right. The predicted growth of plastic in the US is directly connected to the fracking boom. In this week's episode, I'll talk to author and journalist Beth Gardiner, who has documented the connection between fracking and plastic production.
When you pull gas and oil out of the ground with these fracking wells, and whether it's in the Ohio River Valley or down in Texas or out in other parts of the country, you also get a substance known as ethane. And it's helping to keep a lot of fracking companies afloat and a lot of fracking wells running that might well otherwise have closed. The infrastructure to turn that ethane into plastic has expanded.
As well as Jill Hunkler, a seventh generation Ohio Valley resident who had to leave her home after fracking wells made her family sick.
At first, you would notice a burning in your nose, and then headaches and terrible neck aches, nausea. I was forced from my home due to the air pollution from 78 fracking wells, a compressor station that had been in significant and ongoing violations of the Clean Air Act and the Ohio Pollution Control Act for years, pipelines, transfer stations, all within a 5-mile radius of my home.
I'm Lucy Biggers, and this is One Small Step. Fracking is short for hydraulic fracturing, the process of getting natural gas and oil out of sedimentary rock called shale. Fracking wells are built to blast large amounts of water, chemicals, and sand deep underground into the shale, causing it to fracture and release trapped natural gas and oil. The oil and gas is then piped up to the surface and sent to a plant to be used in homes and industry. The water, which is now contaminated with chemicals and radioactive materials present in the shale, also rises to the surface and must be sent to a treatment facility or stored underground in a new injection well. Wastewater and backflow from fracking adds up to 1 trillion gallons a year. According to the U.S. Energy Information Administration, between 2000 and 2015, fracking wells in the United States increased by 1,204%, from 23,000 wells to over 300,000. The fracking industry claims their process is safe and has a lower carbon footprint than coal. But evidence shows that fracking has serious health impacts. Living near fracking wells causes people to develop respiratory issues and problems during pregnancy, as well as risk of exposure to contaminated drinking water and radioactive waste. Think about it. Fracking is sending serious amounts of pressure deep into the earth to disrupt rock, releasing natural gas, chemicals, and radioactive material that have settled into the earth's core. Fracking wells bring all that stuff up to the surface, posing a serious threat to human health. And Jill had 78 fracking wells within 5 miles of her home.
We never knew what we would find when we would get home. You know, they might be fracking on the hill and you'd see the red glow. And then as soon as you would get there, we start having headaches and sinus issues and neck pain. And then it would be so bad. Sometimes we would just leave and go stay with family in, you know, about 20 miles, 15 miles away. Then the symptoms would subside, you know, within an hour or so after leaving the property.
As fracking has increased, so has investment in petrochemical plants that turn ethane into plastic.
It is fair to say that the petrochemical industry, which is plastic is, you know, one of their main products, has been spending a tremendous amount of money, somewhere over $200 billion in the last sort of 10 or so years, just in the United States, to expand their capacity to produce more petrochemicals.
Beth Gardiner is a journalist and author of Choked, Life and Death in the Age of Air Pollution.
The availability of cheap ethane from the fracking boom all across the country is driving this build out. And then the existence of the facilities sort of as a pull factor drives the production of more ethane. So it's kind of a cycle there.
And the environmental impacts don't end at the fracking well. Once ethane is collected from fracking, it's sent to a cracker plant.
So an ethane cracker is an absolutely enormous facility that uses a tremendous amount of energy to crack the ethane molecules into ethylene and then turn them into these tiny little plastic pellets. They're known as nurdles, about the size of a lentil, that then get shipped to companies, manufacturers that are making stuff out of plastic. Any place that has a big plastic production capacity is going to have waters that are filled with these tiny nurdles, and they're really dangerous to sea life. Birds and fish can eat them, and then they starve because they think that they've eaten, but they haven't actually.
You may recognize nurdles from a recent cargo ship accident off the coast of Sri Lanka. The Express Pearl, carrying chemicals and plastic raw materials, exploded, releasing tons of plastic nurdles into the ocean. Dead fish have since washed ashore with nurdles stuck in their gills. Scientists say health and environmental impacts could last for decades. Cracking ethane into ethylene also carries a huge carbon footprint. According to one report, the carbon emissions from the cracking of ethane and an alternative ingredient called naphtha were equivalent to 52 coal-fired power plants in 2015. And that footprint could reach the equivalent of 69 coal plants by 2030 if the industry continues to expand. Jill is currently fighting a cracker plant from being built northwest of Pittsburgh.
The Shell cracker plant in Beaver County, Pennsylvania, of course, is under construction, and I'm terrified about the air pollution that would be coming off of that facility, traveling right down to Pittsburgh, where my daughter lives and where I spend time. And so that is of great concern, and I don't want to give up hope. So I'm asking for people to rally in Pittsburgh and the surrounding areas to really start to stand up against that facility. The amount of infrastructure needed to support a plastics industry built out in the Ohio River Valley would virtually make this place uninhabitable.
The buildout that's happening near Jill's home has already happened in Louisiana, where an 85-mile stretch along the Mississippi River is an area dubbed Cancer Alley, which is home to nearly 150 industrial plants, including dozens of petrochemical facilities. NowThis reported on Cancer Alley in 2017.
I have 100 people in the meeting. Has anybody in the room had anybody in their house die of cancer? Everybody stand up.
Someone just passed away three houses down from cancer.
Because I had one friend, I went and visit her on 4th Street on a Friday. And that Monday morning, I got up, I said, I'm going to go see Mary Alice. I got a call, she was dead. She died of cancer. She had three other sisters. She had two brothers that died with cancer.
Despite the health impacts and the toll on the environment, ethane and plastic production is big business. As Beth wrote for National Geographic, overall, U.S. ethane exports have skyrocketed 585% from 800,000 tons in 2014 to more than 5.5 million tons in 2020. And U.S. ethane now supplies 10% of European ethylene production.
An ethane cracker plastic production plant, for example, in Scotland, that was down to 40% capacity because there wasn't enough ethane in Europe to run it. Now it's back up at 100%, cranking out plastic in the UK.
It's really important to understand that as much as we fight down on plastic consumption, there are serious forces at play. Billions of dollars in investment in fracking and plastic infrastructure have kept plastic cheap and plentiful. No wonder it's an inextricable part of our modern lives. These petrochemical companies have invested billions of dollars, and they need to make their money back by selling more and more plastic.
What is one small step that people can take?
The first is to educate yourself, to really become aware of the crucial issues surrounding plastic. Recognize how important it is to build a coalition around the work we're doing, which is stopping plastic in the production phase. You know, help us in the Ohio River Valley not become the next Cancer Alley and a plastics production corridor.
After researching this issue, I firmly believe it's going to take federal legislation to rein in the plastics industry. One bill that is attempting to take on the plastics industry, which I've talked about in previous episodes of One Small Step, is the Break Free from Plastic Pollution Act. The bill places an immediate moratorium on new plastic facilities and has other measures to rein in plastic production and its associated environmental costs. Check out the bill by Googling Break Free from Plastic Pollution Act. Let me know in the comments, what do you think about the link between fracking and plastic? Are you as shocked as I was? I was shocked. This is mind-blowing. That's all for this video. Thank you so much. And let me know in the comments, fracking and plastic, this connection is unreal to me.